With great joy and pleasure and pride, I'm very happy to introduce to you Cardinal Tauran.
So you are the very positive version of my life. This morning I was a little anxious seeing the program because practically everything I've been said about this encyclical Pacem in Terris, and I was remembering a friend of mine who was a very young Anglican minister, recently ordained, he was 25, and who had great difficulty in preaching. So he resolved the problem. He stole, he found in the rectory in central London parish where he served, a collection of homilies, of sermons, preached by an old missionary Anglican bishop who served very long years in Africa. And so one Sunday morning, in front of a started congregation, he began saying, "My dear brethren, 20 years ago, when I was bishop of Zanzibar, I must say I didn't find any of collection of sermon of toast in the Archbishop's house here in Detroit, so I'm going to try to say something intelligible about this encyclical. I think that we find for the first time, a speech of the Apostolic Nuncio, Angelo Roncalli, at the UNESCO in Paris, delivered in 1951, which gives exactly the essence of the encyclical. He said, "For the souls of goodwill, it is the sentiment of fraternity which shines on the faces of all men like a reflection of the face of God." I think this is exactly the point. And if we want to really understand the Pope Roncalli, the spirituality, we have to remember that from the beginning of his priesthood, he knew of the horror of the war. As a young priest, he was called to service during the First World War, and he served as a surgeon in the medical service of the Italian army. The mutilated bodies, the corpse, and the blood would always haunt his memory. He spent the Second World War as apostolic delegate in Turkey, where he helped saving Jewish families who were traveling towards Israel, and as Apostolic Nuncio in France at the end of 1945, he witnessed firsthand the physical and moral destruction which all wars bring with them. So you can understand how this encyclical Pacem in Terris was something very personal for him. So I am not going to repeat what has been said this afternoon very, very well. So the nature of war was changing. Every potential conflict would become too dangerous if atomic arms were brought into play. War was no longer a means accepted by public opinion as a way to reach justice and peace. Furthermore, the interdependence amongst nations made it easy for the power to put pressure on the way of financial and economical means. From that point of view, we were facing non-armed conflicts, food war, monetary wars, war of migrants, and so on. Furthermore, these changes took place in a context of an incredible development taking place in industrialized countries. Oil was flowing, freeways were being built, air transportation was increasing, cars, telephones, and household equipment, and so everywhere there was abundance and indeed opulence. Even countries which had once been colonized had now gained their independence, and these two were moving towards development. So the reasoning of John the 23rd starts from the fact that God is the foundation of the whole of the moral order. Human rights encompass the relations between men, between political communities. The Pope is convinced that a certain order does exist and that peace is not simply the absence of war, as we have heard this afternoon. It is rather the result of positive relations between individuals and communities. This is why the Pope underlines that even if some aspects of the Declaration of the Human Rights raise some objections from the point of view of Catholic doctrine, nevertheless, we think, says the Pope, that the document should be considered a step in the right direction, an approach towards the establishment of a juridical and political ordering of the world, a solemn recognition of the personal dignity of every human being, an assertion of everyone's right to be free, to seek out the truth, to follow moral principle, to discharge the duties imposed by justice, and lead a fully human life. A second section of the encyclical is the question of disarmament. The Pope expressed himself as follows. There is a common belief that peace cannot be assured except on an equal balance of armaments. Consequently, people are living in the grip of constant fear. Hence, justice, right reason, and recognition of man's dignity cry out insistently for a cessation to the arms race. The stockpiles of armaments must be reduced, nuclear weapons must be banned, and therefore he asks that the arms race be stopped. The Pope bases this thinking upon reason, but also upon utility. He asks, what does war actually bring except destruction? And he pleads for an international equilibrium that is truly human. But he had also something else. He considered that disarmament should be accompanied by mutual confidence among nations, by loyalty in diplomacy, and by the observance of the provision laid down in treaties, Pacta Sunt Servanda. Then there is also an important point addressed by the encyclical letter, the need for international institutions, and Monsieur Minorat has dealt with the problem, so I'm going to repeat. The Pope thinks that worldwide political authority is necessary because the national public powers have no sufficient authority to bring about the universal common good. The universal common good gives rise to problems of the utmost gravity, complexity, and urgency, said the Pope. The rulers of individual nations, being all on an equal footing, largely fail in their efforts to achieve this, however much they multiply their meetings and their endeavors to discover a more fitting instrument of peace. This universal common good presents problems which are worldwide in their dimensions, and therefore the solution cannot be found except by a public authority equipped with worldwide power, This public authority, of course, must be used as an equitable instrument, not simply an instrument to serve the interest of the few or to take the side of the single nation. Today, the universal common good, say the Pope, consequently demands the establishment of some general form of public authority. Unfortunately, in spite of the development of international organization, such worldwide authority is still lacking. Like Pius XII, he underlines the positive aspects in the United Nations organization and hopes that the same organization might adapt its mission of guaranteeing the rights of the human person. We must remember that at that time, in 1961, the United Nations had recently emerged from the stalemate in which the Cold War had left it. It is therefore the wish of the Pope that such an organization may be able progressively to adapt its method of operation to the magnitude and nobility of its task. So we can be only impressed by the accuracy of this perspective formulated 50 years ago. We must recall the importance which John the 23rd attached to the universal common good. One can understand also how it is that this encyclical gained such popularity. It met with people's practical concerns and anxieties. The encyclical gave the image of the Church in touch with the cares of the whole humanity, in particular with those suffering the ravages of injustice and of war. The Church became expert in humanity, as Paul VI would later describe her on the occasion of his visit to the United Nations in New York. John the 23rd invited the Church to recognize all the positive values of the world and prepared the ground for the Second Vatican Council, especially the Pastorate Constitution Gaudium et Spes. It is important to note that the encyclical was not simply addressed, as has been observed this afternoon, to the Catholics, but also to all men and women of goodwill. It is the first encyclical which sought to foster dialogue with non-believers, with Marxist movement in particular, and recognizing the positive elements which could be approved. This is a famous distinction between the error which has to be condemned and the errant who must be respected. We can say that John the 23rd offers a pedagogy of peace. It does so by building peace upon the four pillars of truth, justice, love, and freedom. Truth, which is the foundation of relations between men and states, because every human being is capable of God. Justice, which is the role of action, the rule of action. Love, which is a motto, and freedom, which is a framework. John the 23rd was an optimistic man, as it has been said, sustained as he was by his deep trust in God. He was convinced that every human being is capable of God, capable also of discovering the divine order because he has been made in the image of God, endowed with intelligence and freedom, and made Lord of creation. He was convinced that the efforts for peace must be brought about in accordance with the divine established order. It is a pity that the Pope's declarations about human rights and disarmament, or what he said about the United Nations, have merely received a certain appreciation, but have not been totally put into practice. Pope John had a concrete vision of peace, and he invited Catholics to live and collaborate with all men and women, since for him, peace is a good which interests all and without distinction. The horror of war, the demands of living in harmony with the modern world, concretely seeking peace, the art of encounter with the other, all of these inspire the diplomacy of peace so characteristic of John the 23rd, a patrimony which continues to inspire the action of pontifical diplomacy still today. Many of John the 23rd's intuitions would later also be found in the Pastoral Constitution, Gaudium et Spes. And this encyclical also would facilitate contact with non-Christian and non-believers. So I conclude with borrowing, if I may say so, my words to an English poet, William Wake. I sought my soul, but my soul I couldn't see. I sought my God, but my God eluded me. I sought my brother, and I found all three. Thank you.